He wouldn't come to London when we invited him. He's always, I believe, disliked the place. Micheál Mac Liammóir, spelt in the Gaelic way, but I have not said it in the Gaelic way, have I?
It's quite simple.
Micheál. Have I got it right about you disliking London?
You have it right in a way and wrong in another way. I disliked it when I first went there. Intensely, I felt I was in prison in a terrifying, huge place full of rather send-up-y people, you know. And I had very curly hair in those days, lots of it. And when I walked down the street, the little boys used to shout out to me, "Get your hair cut," which did not please me very much, you can imagine.
Get your hair cut, there's a barber around the corner.
There's a
barber. That's the full one.
Pies must have a crust on. Why don't you join the army? Get your hair cuts on. However, from the moment I went on the stage, which I did at the age of 10 because we had no money, and we all had to earn our livings, we children had four sisters and no brothers in those days. And I went on the stage, and from that moment I loved London with passion and loved everything about it.
But you didn't want to stay.
I didn't want to stay for one strange reason. I came under the strong influence of the poet William Butler Yeats, who did more good and more harm to make Ireland a nation worthwhile belonging to than any other living man, I think. One of the very great poets. The greatest Irish poet, I think, in either language, the Irish or the English languages. He's English language, of course. And superb poet and a very, very great patriot and a tremendous influence for good and bad, like a lot of patriots in all countries.
Are you a patriot then?
Oh, no.
Why not?
Because I've grown out of it. Isn't that a dreadful thing to say?
No, it's not a dreadful thing to say, but it's an interesting thing to say.
Well, I recognise that organized nationalism, like so much organized religion, are the roots of so much evil in the world and so much unhappiness, so much hatred and prejudice. The worst example of all that has been was, I think, in Nazi Germany, when race prejudice inevitably led to the gas chamber and to unspeakable cruelties because of a hatred of a whole race. That was founded on acute and, I'm sure, deeply and sincerely felt nationalism on the part of Adolf Hitler.
But if you're not a patriot, in the sense of being a nationalist, you were a very strong, ardent Irishman, weren't you?
I hope am, in a way. I have great ambitions for Ireland. I have great ambitions for Ireland's capital, Dublin, where we are now. But they're all rather disappointed. And I believe that the founders of our nation, the modern founders, from Yeats himself in one direction, to Arthur Griffith, to Michael Collins, to all of them, to De Valera, all of them. I think they would be very disappointed if they came back. I don't know if De Valera would, but I'm sure that the other men would.
Disappointed in what?
That they, what we dreamed of at the opening of this century, especially when there was this great, what was called the Celtic Revival, there was such hope in everybody's heart. In the year 1917, I played my last boy's part at the Haymarket Theatre as a boy actor in London, as I had begun when I was 10. And the last performance I gave was in a play called Felix Gets a Month at the Haymarket Theatre, and it got a month too.
Closed that romance.
It closed up after that. And I had already decided that when I could get back to Ireland, I would. So I came to Ireland's capital, though it's not my native city. But I came back to it because it was the capital and I was hoping for great things. We all were. We dreamed of the most wonderful possibilities of Dublin becoming a sort of another sort of Paris, if you will, another London, another Berlin, another what you will.
You hated the men who left, the talented artists who left
Dublin. No, I didn't hate them. I understood them completely. It was the only thing for them to do. But they did go away. Everyone in that great series of Irish-born writers, entirely of comedy, practically, from Farquhar and Sheridan, Goldsmith, to Wilde and Shaw. I don't put them in that in that order necessarily from prejudice, but although I personally prefer Wilde to Shaw any day.
Tell me this then, if you can. Could you define what the best in an Irishman is?
Ho ho! What is the best in any man of any nationality, or woman either? We mustn't forget the ladies.
Right.
We must not forget women's lib, even if we try to. No. The best in an Irishman, I think, is a fundamental sense, fundamental and incurable, thank God, of mysticism. I think it does exist there, though it finds its own way out in the most peculiar manners, often, by throwing bombs, by doing all sorts of appalling things.
Mysticism is what, then?
A belief that this life is not all, that there is in a man, as the Theosophists say, and I think it's profoundly true, that there is in a human being more than what exists between his hat and his boots. Mm. You know what I mean.
Do you believe that?
I do. I believe in the soul, the existence of a soul, apart from the body. Its house is the body.
As the house gets older, do you hate the house more and more?
More and more, madam, I couldn't answer with greater enthusiasm. I loathe old age as much as my dear friend Faye Compton does. We neither of us can face it. We were both good-looking creatures, I in my own homely way. She is a raving beauty and an artist of almost, for a great city like London, of almost fatal versatility. A lady who could play Ophelia one week and Dick Whittington the following month with equal verve and brilliance.
I wonder whether it is, though, that old age, the bodily business of old, getting old, is much worse for somebody who was very good-looking when they were young. It must be so.
Yes, and it isn't only looks, it's vigour, you see. It's,
right.
It's energy, it's full of that wonderful feeling of liveliness, of looking forward to the next day, of being able to go through with life and long for the following day, long for the show at night. You no longer feel fit for the show at night, you see.
Do you know what made me sad at lunch when I was talking to you?
Yes.
You always kept a diary, didn't you?
I did. Years and years.
And now you don't, you say.
I don't because I haven't as much sense of the future as I had. At my age, a man doesn't have very much sense of the future except a couple of years more of discomfort or growing illness or something, and then death. So it's difficult. I do look forward to what Hilton and I have created in the Gate Theatre, to a new form of finding new, young and brilliant directors, designers, actors and so on.
You know, you mentioned death.
Yes.
You told me also at lunchtime today.
Yes.
That you have nearly died.
Yes, I did once.
What was it like?
It was wonderful. I had a coronary, I think it's called. I'm very bad on terms. It was a heart attack brought on by a series of absurd accidents, which included the taking of pills and also included a midnight matinee that I had no idea it existed until I was faced with it. At 8 o'clock, when I expected to go down to the theatre to be third on the programme, in an excerpt from my Oscar Wilde show in Coventry. And to my astonishment and horror, I was not informed that it was a midnight matinee until 8 o'clock. When my manager was eating his dinner, and I said, "You're a bit late with your dinner, aren't you? We're due at the theatre." Oh, he said, "But we're not. It's a midnight matinee." So, full of horror, I went home very tired and a little bit hungry, and the next day was confronted on my journey home to Dublin. I was confronted with a spectacle of my dear partner meeting us both and saying, "You're looking a bit funny." Funny was not exactly the right word, but you know, he said it, I think. And I was looking bloody awful, if I may quote Pygmalion. Not bloody likely. I went home, and shivering fits attacked me, and I got what's called a rigor when you do this, you know. And next day I was in hospital in what I think is called the extensive, no?
Intensive.
Intensive, thank you. The intensive ward. And not having the courage or the bravura of wonderful Sybil Thorndike, who, when she was there for the same sort of thing, would not be kept quiet. She said, "Oh, look at that old man there. Look at his picture on the... Oh, hoppity, hop, hop, hop." And I said, "Dame Sybil, please. Hoppity, hop, hop, hop," she said defiantly, and survived.
And insisted on knowing exactly every little detail of any operation that had to happen to her, by the way, she told me when I interviewed her. Yes.
God bless her, isn't she wonderful? Yeah.
Carry on.
No, I can't carry on from that because it was so tremendous. And when I was there and death was very near, I wasn't thinking hoppity hop 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 in that courageous way that would take me through for 25 or 30 years more as she was. I was just thinking I was dying, and it was delicious. I have never had a more delightful experience.
How was it delicious? Because I'd be scared stiff, I think.
I was, too, by Wilde's quotation, not quotation, his own speech that he puts into the mouth of Herod in Salome. It is not death, but the approach of death that frightens me. Mm. But this approach was so wonderful. Oh, my dear, it was golden, reassuring, peaceful and lovely, like going home. And I thought, this is perfect, how wonderful. I suppose I should have died then, it would have been grand. But I turned to the side, I saw my poor old Hilton kneeling by the bed with such a broken face and so utterly stricken by the possibility of my dying, because we are very close, he and I. Mm. And he said, would it be terrible, would you think it terrible of me if you do die, God forbid, said he. But if you do die, if I followed you deliberately. And I said, no, of course not. But at that moment, I decided, oh, I don't think I'll do it yet. No, I think I'll wait a couple of years more, you know. So I have. Ha ha! There you are.
I'm glad.
Thanks.
Can I put a question, though? If Hilton was willing to kill himself, you mean, because you were going to die, if you died, would you have done that for him?
Oh, decidedly. I still think I would, if he dies before me. But he hates me to say that. He's one of the things he forbids me to say. He said, do not talk about it if you don't want to. Mm. Depress and disgust me. Mm. Perhaps he's forgotten, he said it himself. Mm. I don't know.
Can I go on to your...
I do.
...career as an actor?
Career as an actor?
Yes.
Ah, ha, ha, that was lovely. It started so beautifully with a job my father got for me. My mother saw in a London newspaper. We were living in London at the time, 1910. I'm the age of the century, so I can never deny it. You know, it's no good, because they say, ah, no, in 1918, you were 18. It's perfectly true, you see. But in that job that he got for me, there was an advertisement my mother saw looking for pretty, talented children. She said, there he is, said my mother. Ah, look, Miss Lila Field. She was producing a play. She'd written herself, called The Goldfish, for children entirely. Boys and girls. And I went up, and there was nobody in the cast over 14. Rather an alarming proposition, I think, for...
Where was this? Where?
In London.
Yes.
We opened after indescribable length of rehearsals, which caused public scandals. And the rehearsals went on and on. And my first rehearsal, the first person I saw, was Noel Coward. Also 10 years old, but 2 months and 3 weeks, I think, younger than I was, to his delight. You see, Noel was the opposite of Peter Pan. He was essentially young then, from actual fact, by his age. But he was grown up from the word go, you see. And I remember sitting next to him at that rehearsal in 1910 in a studio in which Miss Field said, how do you like the way I've arranged my stage? So I looked in vain for a stage, and there was no stage. There was a derangement of furniture, and that's what she meant by her stage. And the garden gate is here, you see, and this is the big elm tree, and so. There was nothing of the kind, you see. And I looked rather bewildered, and I sat down next to Noel and said, you're Noel Coward, aren't you? He said, yes. I said, well, I'm Alfred Wilmore. That was my name as a stage actor when I was a child. My father's name was Alfred. My own name is Michael. And he said, I said, what do you want to be when you're grown up, Noel? He said, an actor, of course. Otherwise, I shouldn't be here. What do you want to be? So I said, a little dashed, I said, I don't know. Well, you should know, says Noel. Everybody should know exactly what they want to be. He was always doing that, even at that age, you see. But he was quite wonderful.
What did you say, though, that you wanted to be? You must have had a clue.
One of the things I wanted to be was a farmer. Another thing was a draper's assistant in a certain shop in Cork where I was reared. And not in the shop, but I mean in the city. And the Munster Arcade was the name of the shop. And I longed to be one of those fellows who had bales of cloth and smash. Smash.
You had lovely thump on the
lovely
counter.
Rather damp thump.
Right.
And then they would take the change, you see, take the note, whatever it was, put it in a little screw-up thing and hoosh it up to a wire that went right across the shop, and that fascinated.
Stored it, and so did I.
Oh, I thought it was ideal to be that.
Don't think you're too old for me. I mean, me too young for me to remember that. I remember that very,
very
vividly.
You do remember that.
Loved it. Loved it.
Wasn't it fascinating?
Did you or did you not say that an actor is not an escapist?
I don't think I said it. I don't think he is an escapist, but I don't remember ever having said it or written it. I may have done.
Don't you think there is a danger in an actor that he uses the stage for real life and that real life is in the way?
If that is a danger, yes, decidedly.
You say if it is a danger?
If it is a danger, yes, he does do that, I think. I know I did it, and I think most of my fellow actors did it. One lived all day long by the show at night. This is the reality. This is the truth. This is it, you see. How much more wonderful the words sometimes of the great poets like Shakespeare. How much more wonderful on that raw, uncooked vegetable we called ordinary life. And when the curtain came down, we all died a little. We still do, if we're playing. Every time the curtain comes down at the end of a stage show, you have died in a way. And your work is wiped out until the movies came along and television came along, and that can be preserved if it's worthwhile preserving, I suppose.
I wondered whether because of that transitory flavour that your life, you know, that you can't get a record of what you've done as a theatre actor, is that perhaps why you wrote books?
Perhaps it was. Perhaps it was also because I'm a born jack of all trades. Just as I'm a good enough linguist to be a head waiter, nothing more. Still, you know, languages are easy to me. Any form of mechanism is impossible to me. I don't know. I can't drive a car. I can't do anything mechanical. It's a closed book to me and infuriates all my friends.